Welcome to another episode of the Ins and Outs of Work. And today we have a fantastic guest with us. His name is Raj Choudhury. And we are going to talk about remote work and specifically work from anywhere and the movement that comes with that. So welcome, Raj. Perhaps we can start with, where are you currently working from?
So I'm in Boston today. Great to be here, Navy.
Yeah, great to have you. Raj, I'd like to start with, what has COVID changed about the work from anywhere movement, if anything?
So thanks for having me again, Neely. The work from anywhere movement started, I want to say, a decade back. And I've been studying this since 2015, well before the pandemic. So what the work from anywhere movement really is about is giving people the choice on where they want to live, instead of the company forcing people to live where the company has an office. And I got really interested in this phenomena when I studied the United States Patent Office. And turns out the Patent Office had allowed its workers to work from home back from 2007, but they still had to live close to the office. The office of the Patent Office is in Alexandria, Virginia, close to Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. But then in 2012, they said, now you can go and work and live in any part of the U.S. So you can go to Florida, you can go to California, you choose. And you don't have to come back to the office maybe once or twice a year for some training. So I studied that and I got really excited about it. And there are lots of benefits for people, for companies, for society that I'm studying. But I think the pandemic has really made this movement mainstream. So now I see companies across different industries letting workers work from anywhere.
Interesting, Raj. Also, do you remember what were some of the considerations for the patent office to tell their people, okay, now you can work from anywhere within the US?
So the way they did it was they essentially said that you had to be enrolled in the work from home program. That was the first condition. Mm-hmm. And then because you had to be enrolled in the work from home program, they had to be at least, they at least needed 2 years of experience in the patent office prior to that. So it was a stepwise change for them. At least 2 years in the office, then you work from home, then you work from anywhere. Mm-hmm. But I've seen, you know, I've worked with many companies now, including the all remote companies, that don't even have an office. So the entire company is working from anywhere all over the world. Mm-hmm. And for them, there are no such restrictions. You know, you join the company, you work from anywhere. So I think the patent office had those restrictions, but I don't think those restrictions are generally needed for companies to let people work from anywhere.
Interesting as well. Now, Raj, I think we fast forward a bit now to today and the results for many companies of last year's events. We just mentioned it briefly, but of course, a lot of organizations decided to go remote, either as much as possible, or and some of them even deciding to remain remote. They already stated that, even though the pandemic is, of course, not over yet. However, many people, they feel that the engagement and productivity of the people working in their organization, they are dropping in a remote work setting. Now, I know that in your research, you found a strong positive link between work from anywhere and employee engagement and productivity. What can you tell us about this?
So the first thing I would tell people is that the period of remote work we have all experienced in the prior 1 year is not quote-unquote normal. So when I was studying remote work back in 2016, with Patent Office or GitLab or Zapier, then you didn't have kids at home doing homeschool. You were not forced to not go to a gym. You could go to a cafeteria. You could go to a co-working space, experience, quote-unquote, like an office-like environment. So I think that's the world we should imagine. The world we should imagine is one where we have vaccines, we have flexibility, and we have our lives back. And in that world, I think work from anywhere would work really well for many, many people because our stress levels would be lower. we would truly have flexibility. And if some of us like to work in an office, we could go to an office for a few days or a few weeks in the year, or we could go to a co-working space if we enjoy that in-person engagement. And the last thing I'll say, and I can talk more about that, Neely, even in a work from anywhere organization that's practicing all remote or hybrid remote work, there are ways to stimulate employee engagement. So it's a management problem. It's not like something that cannot be solved.
Yeah. So what you're saying, Raj, is also that we need to imagine the current remote work situation that has often been kind of forced upon us, of course, given the events of last year. We need to see that separately from a remote work situation or a work from anywhere situation, in which the extra challenges, such as having indeed children at home that we need to homeschool, these are two different situations, and we need to look at the latter to basically have the full benefits of this remote work setup. Am I right?
Yes, and I think there are ways, and I can talk of two ways to stimulate engagement. Imagine 2022, we are working from anywhere, we all have vaccines, our worries have gone down. The two ways to stimulate engagement in that scenario for an all remote or a hybrid remote company would be to have periods, short spells, where the teams come together face to face. So one specific example is a company I'm working with is TCS, Tata Consulting Services. So they are a technology behemoth. They have 500,000 employees worldwide. They previously had 16 campuses, so very much office-driven culture. And last year, they decided to go 75% remote, which means every employee, starting from the CEO to the person who joined yesterday, would be only be in an office for 25% of their time. But the beauty of the model is, you know, that 25% in office won't be decided by the company or by the individual. It would be decided by the team. So some teams would say, we'll come 2 days a week. That's our heartbeat. Some teams could say, we'll only come to office 1 week every month. And we'll decide. It's the final week or the first week. And some teams could say, we'll come for a few weeks in February. And then we'll meet everyone again in, I don't know, November. And then we'll do like something in between. So every team does these short spells of co-location, which creates the bonding between the team. And the other tool that I would encourage people to think about is something I've studied quite extensively, and that's the tool of virtual water coolers. And the idea of the virtual water cooler is not the same as a Zoom happy hour. It's very different. So the idea is that in a physical office, we had these serendipitous conversations, the water cooler conversations. But the truth is, we had those conversations only with 5 or 10 people on the same floor of our office building, rarely with anyone else. But in a virtual water cooler, what happens is someone in the company randomly puts together groups of people. And in doing that, that person puts together marketing with R&D, engineering with sales, cuts across functional groups, cuts across hierarchy, so brings the CEO to talk to the interns, cuts across geography, and then these calls are mandatory. These are not like, I don't have a choice. I have to join the call at least for 15 minutes. So what it avoids is an echo chamber of the same 10 people Zooming every week, and it leads to way more connections than in the old physical office. So I would say between the temporary co-location and virtual water coolers, we can have a very engaged set of employees, even when we are working from anywhere.
Yeah, I very much like what you said, Raj, as well, about how the teams drive the moments that they decide to be together in the office, and how it's not been decided by either the organization or the individuals, but very much by the team. I very much like that. And also very interesting, this cross-pollination that you get between different departments through these virtual water coolers. So very, very interesting to hear about. Raj, I wanted to briefly touch on some of the benefits of work from anywhere, and then in particular for individuals, even though most people might already have heard about them, and also for organizations, if you want.
Sure. So the benefit of work from anywhere for individuals is what I call geographic flexibility, that we choose where we want to live, and we can choose based on cost of living. So many of the people I've studied in my studies in the US Patent Office or Tulsa Remote, they moved to cheaper cities. And if the company pays you the same salary, that means you have more money in your pocket to buy a bigger house or afford daycare, which would make you more productive. It's also going to lead people to probably in many cases live closer to their families, to live closer to elderly parents or extended family. It's really good for dual career situations because now, you know, I've studied military spouses and the spouses in the diplomatic corps. Mm-hmm. And women have borne the brunt of dual careers for decades. So even if a woman, very talented woman, had a promotion opportunity that would need them to move from, I don't know, Paris to Brussels, the spouse doesn't want to move, so she foregoes of the promotion opportunity. But with work from anywhere, you don't have to move anywhere. You can get the promotion without moving or changing cities. So I think for the individual, there are many, many good reasons. You can choose to live in Paris if you like the food. You can choose to live in the Alps if you like skiing. You really take control of your life and your geography. For the company, there are three benefits. One is you can now, with work from anywhere, you can hire from anywhere. You are not constrained to the labor market of the location of your office. The second benefit is it creates a more inclusive workforce for women, for people with disabilities. Many people with disabilities cannot move to large cities like New York. But they can now work from anywhere. And the third benefit is there is, of course, a productivity gain, which is, something I've documented. But you also have lower real estate costs and lower utilities costs and a lower carbon footprint. So I think this is a great thing for workers. It's a great thing for companies and something I think every CEO should consider.
Raj, I'm slightly changing tack here, going back to your research still. So you mentioned that there can also be issues around communication and knowledge sharing in a work from anywhere setup. And I think many of us might feel that they are all living through this at the moment. But what are some ways to address these issues that you've come across?
There are two specific things I'll highlight. So the first thing is there has to be a commonly shared, transparent handbook. Think about it as the company's own Wikipedia, where knowledge is documented in real time. And this knowledge would be about all the relevant knowledge that individuals need to work, specifically knowledge that answers any question that starts with the word how. So how do I file an expense report? How do I do this? There has to be an answer in this common handbook. And those answers need to be updated. It has to be real time. Because when I'm working from anywhere, I don't have the ability to walk into my colleague's cubicle and tap their shoulder and ask that how question. So the answers need to be written down. And someone needs to be accountable for every page of the handbook. And they need to be evaluated on the quality of knowledge of the handbook through their KPIs. So that's the first solution, the KPI, the handbook. The second solution to communication is we need to cut down, drastically reduce our Zoom meetings. Because there is a lot of Zoom fatigue that is happening. And what we have done is really we have taken the conference room and whiteboard model of meeting to online. And it doesn't work from anywhere because people are living in different time zones. And then you have to sometimes stay up at midnight or crazy hours to do these meetings. And the reality is these meetings don't produce the best ideas. Because even in a conference room with a whiteboard or a Zoom meeting, everyone is thinking on their feet. They're not giving thoughtful answers after long introspection. But if you embrace asynchronous work, which is something I'm studying and recommending, so it could be through a Slack channel or a Doist channel, or even as simple as a shared Google document, then everyone can contribute their ideas and brainstorm without having a Zoom meeting. And then everyone gets time to reflect. So I can read what Nelly wrote. I can go for a walk with the dog and think about what she wrote and come back with a more thoughtful answer. So I think we need to write down more, and we need to read more, and we need to avoid constantly Zooming each other.
Yes, that's very interesting that you say that, Raj. I was actually listening to a podcast with Matt Mullenweg in it a while ago. Obviously, yeah, you know it, I imagine, because you do a lot of research, and they are also fully remote, as you probably know. And he was indeed talking about this asynchronous phase, actually, because he speaks of several phases. But he says when the company gets to this asynchronous phase of working together, one of the biggest advantages indeed is that people who during a meeting are a bit shy or need time to reflect before they come with a reaction, they actually flourish in this kind of setup, because they can get the time to reflect and then write down their thoughts, write down their ideas, and that benefits the company as a whole and the decision making and the idea generation. So interesting that you're mentioning the same thing. Something else, Raj, that I wanted to talk about is many organizations at the moment, they are looking what to do. Are we going fully remote? Are we developing a hybrid work mode where some people are remote, others they are in the office, or people can decide what they want to do? Have you in your research come across already in any difference in outcomes for individuals and organizations when the model is hybrid versus fully remote?
So I think, the first thing I'll say is that there are different shades of hybrid. There is good hybrid and there's terrible hybrid. So the terrible hybrid is when everyone is deciding when to show up. So if you and I are on the same team, but you come Monday, Tuesday, and I come Thursday, Friday, then we'll never see each other. So one of the principles of good hybrid, I don't think we can just compare hybrid to all remote. We need to first compare good hybrid to bad hybrid. And there has to be some principles of good hybrid. So I think the first principle of good hybrid is there has to be uniformity. So when the team is coming to the physical office, everyone has to come to the physical office. The second principle of good hybrid is everyone has to work remote first. So even on the days I show up in an office, I have to still behave like a remote worker, because there might be some colleagues even on that day, maybe not on my team, but some other teams who are working remotely that day. So I cannot just act like an office worker, find three of my buddies and go to a whiteboard and start writing. I still have to do everything that I'm supposed to do as a remote worker, which means all calls need to be remote inclusive. All codification, writing down knowledge still has to continue. We still have to do asynchronous. So all the good habits of remote have to still continue even on the days you're coming to an office. And if you do that, I think the hybrid model works really well. I have no issues with it. But the final thing is the hybrid model should not take away the flexibility of work from anywhere. So it should not be everyone in this company does 3 days a week in the office and 2 days from home, because then you cannot sell your house and go somewhere else. So I really like that TCS 25% model, because that 25% can give you 3 weeks working from anywhere and then fly, or take a short train ride for 1 week and take an Airbnb and do that 1 week in the office. So I think if we can do all of that, hybrid could work great.
Yeah, I totally agree with you that there's a good hybrid and a bad hybrid. I know that one of the pushbacks to hybrid, let's call it bad hybrid, is also often that people feel that they do not have the same opportunities in terms of promotions and et cetera as people who have the possibility to go to the office more often. So I think this is a really good point that you're making with the bad hybrid and the good hybrid. Do you think, Raj, that there are organizations for which work from anywhere is not suited at all?
So I'm a believer, I'm probably one of the leading evangelists of Work From Anywhere now. So I, in my world, in my view, it can work pervasively. And even if there are being, there are so many innovations coming in sectors that you would not imagine. So in the oil exploration sector or the manufacturing sector, you would imagine that people would have to work in a plant, in a physical factory or an oil rig. And there's a really interesting digital twins model now, where there is a digital replica of the physical plant or the physical oil rig. And now at least the maintenance engineers and the design engineers don't have to be in the plant. They can work with the digital replica and they can work from anywhere. So I think we will see increasing innovations that enable better communication, better knowledge sharing, better knowledge codification. People just want that flexibility. I think for decades, we have forced people to, you know, live where they don't want to live. And I think that's, that genie is out of the bottle.
Yeah, I hope so, Raj. I hope so. And I think you're right. If there are people from organizations listening today that are in charge of how the organization is operating, either in office or hybrid or work from anywhere, if they are thinking, okay, let's try to get our organization from an in-office setup, for example, towards a work from anywhere setup, what are some of the first steps that they should take, if you can say anything about that in general?
So selfishly, I would say, please read my Harvard Business Review article.
All right.
That was the cover story of the November-December 2020 HBR. And I lay out 10 organizational processes, starting with how you measure productivity, how you communicate, how you socialize, how you take up data security, how you mentor people, how you onboard people, and on and on and on. So I had recommendations on all of that. So this is a management problem. So if you decide, you should decide, it's good for you as a company. It's good for your workers to have that flexibility. It's really about how do we do this? And that is an organizational transformation project.
Yeah.
And so it's not like a technological problem. It's a management problem. And so my HBR article talks about that organizational transformation and which processes you will need to reevaluate.
Fantastic. So everyone listening, read Raj's HBR article, December 2020, if I'm correct. Raj, let's take a peek into the future. I know we don't have a crystal ball, but still. So fast forward to next year, 3 to 5 years from now, where do you think that we will be with this? Will work from anywhere be the default?
I think so. We will not talk about remote work, because remote work will become work. And I think my crystal ball, you know, I'm terrible in crystal ball gazing, but my hope is that work from anywhere will let people move from our over-congested cities to smaller towns, which are beautiful. And I know France has many of them, which are cheaper, which need talent. Some of them will become entrepreneurs in these smaller towns once they move. People will return home. So many people living in the West but want to go back to India or China or Africa or Indonesia will do so. So we'll have a more equitable distribution of where people live. And that's going to be good for our over-congested cities. It's going to be good for our smaller towns. It's going to be good for all of our communities. And that's my hope.
I think that is a beautiful way to end this conversation about work from anywhere, Raj, to be honest with you. And I think it's a beautiful message for the future and a positive one as well. I want to thank you so much for joining us today on this episode on the ins and outs of work.
Thank you, Nili. Great to be here.
Yeah, great to have you, Raj. And thank you, everyone, for listening to today's episode. Don't forget, if you like this episode, subscribe to our channel, share this episode with your friends. And see you next time. Goodbye.